Definitional neutrality. Definitional neutrality is neither nor. Continue to practice this, and I want to continue to emphasize this. Do not ask questions such as, what does enlightenment feel like? What does oneness feel like? Ask rather, what practice can I do that will get me the results that I truly want? And just do the practice. Don't worry about the results, trying to describe or define the results, because really what we're practicing is definitional neutrality. Neither nor. I'm neither excited about it, nor am I not excited about it. Which brings us to the day here, which it was an extraordinary day, and but I've been practicing the neither nor. I'm neither interested nor not interested. Whatever reaction you're having, put it into a neither nor format, because we're practicing definitional neutrality, which enables us then to go into what's called abidance. We cannot go into no definition at all. That's beyond the scope of our goals here. Ultimately we will, but the intermediate step takes us into this simply definitional neutrality. So it's a little different than realizing that there is no definition whatsoever. Definition doesn't exist. What we are cannot be defined. However, the intermediate step is said to be, we'll say, definitional neutrality. So whatever one's reactions are to whatever the news is, say, well, I'm neither this nor that. I'm neither happy nor not happy. I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. So I've had an opportunity to practice today under an extraordinary set of circumstances. And I've been able to effectively practice this. There's something. And I continue to practice it. It's quite extraordinary. What is this? There's some sort of something getting in the visual field. Okay, so what happened today that has prompted such great practicing? For one, I was given an inside view of the best car in the world, actually. The best car you can buy in the world. I won't say what it is or whatever, but I was shown the inside of it, and look here, and I said, oh yeah, it's nice, and it's like so deluxe, it's ridiculous. Okay, so I was like, well, I'm neither surprised nor not surprised. I'm neither impressed nor am I not impressed. I'm neither impressed nor am I not impressed. Neither impressed nor not impressed. Try to keep this definitional neutrality about what you're experiencing. What we're reacting, because we're really just reacting to our definitions. What we're going for is a well, I can say that without trying to describe it exactly, because I cannot, but I was driving along today and I felt that there was something coming upon me subtly, very subtly. By doing this neither nor practice, it leads to the results, I believe, that what we really want. And so I felt this very subtle awareness, very subtle. It's so subtle I cannot really describe it, you see, it's so subtle. But I sort of, it was just like there was something omnipresent that was like totally solid and permanent. A sort of subtle sense of this presence of omnipresent permanency and stability. Seeming to, everywhere I looked, I sort of felt this, but it was so subtle. You could say, well, maybe I'm just imagining this. Well, this is how subtle it was. So, but interesting way to experience is to say, well, maybe I'm just imagining this. I'm neither experiencing this, nor am I not experiencing this. I'm neither imagining it, nor am I not imagining it. Definitional neutrality. Maintain this neutral state, definitional neutral state. And it's enough to not go against truth, right, in order for truth to dawn upon us. And the dawning seems to be so subtle that you can't really say, well, is this my imagination, or I'm actually experiencing this? There's no way to really tell. It seemed that subtle. So I know people thinking of breakthrough. So where's the breakthrough? I don't think there is any breakthrough, actually. We can say there neither is a breakthrough nor is there not a breakthrough. But I don't think you can call it a breakthrough at all. It seems to just be this super, super gentle, subtle dawning that you could overlook, you know, in an instant. I mean, it's, and yet it can be there, and you can just say, you sort of notice, but at the same time you say it's so subtle, you know, what is there to do other than just notice it? You're not really going to try and define it or describe it or grab a hold of it or anything like that. Very subtle dawning. So I just said, oh, okay, well, whatever. I don't know what to say. I really don't know what to say of it because it's so subtle. I don't know where it's going or exactly, you know, but seemed as though something is arriving from this practice of neither nor. There is some sort of arrival taking place. Now, another issue arose today, and it centered around this camera, which I found lying in a trash heap today. This is the Kodak 1A, Kodak 1A, 1A Pocket Kodak. It's called the 1A Pocket Kodak. I looked it up online, and I found that it was manufactured from 1926 to 1932. So I'm holding in my hands. Somebody had just thrown it away, and I saw it. And I said, what in the world is this? This looks like an old camera. It is an old camera. So sometime between 1926 and 1932, this was manufactured. And this is Bellows camera. It used a, I don't know how it worked, but you push this in like this, and then you can somehow, you can somehow close it up like this and just, and put that in your pocket or something like that. This is, it's a heavy son of a gun. It's like, wow. So, 1926, 1932, and I just picked this camera up. I said, there's something important about this. I don't know what it is. Then it suddenly flashed in my mind, hey, wait a minute. Isn't that the time that Ananda Maima and Shabag went through this, started to be known to the world in general? And didn't she leave Shabag in 1932? I said, this is right in the time of Ananda Maima and Shabag. I said, and so I looked it up, and indeed, it was true. In June of 1932, she left Dhaka for good. Shabag Gardens is in Dhaka. And in 1926, her practice of the sadhaka or sadhana ended. And she moved to Shabag, I think, in 1924. But she was still undergoing this spiritual path type of thing she was doing, looking at all different paths. And then in 1926, she stopped that and started meeting with people in the world, started meeting. So pretty doggone interesting that I'd find a camera like this. And also looks like a camera I had in a dream back in 1997, I think, when I seemed to interact with Ananda Maima in the dream. And did I have the camera? Or did she? I think I may have had the camera, some kind of old camera. I had some sort of old camera. And here is this, suddenly this old camera just falls right into my hands here today. But I find that I was reading some teachings and words of Ananda Maima, someone had written down. I said, I'm neither interested nor not interested. You know, is she one of the heavyweights that may show up here? It's possible that huge bunya pine cone signifies some spiritual heavyweights are going to show up. Something spiritual heavyweightness is going to show up. But am I interested? Well, I'd say I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. I'm neither excited about it nor not excited about it. I really have this neutral feeling about it. I mean, just neutral, definitional neutrality about it. And so I've been practicing this around that. And I neither care nor do I not care. I neither think it's important nor do I think it's not important. So I'm actually able to maintain this definitional neutrality in the face of this notion that some great teacher is going to be present in the world. I said, well, I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. How about that? Extraordinary. So I remain centered, I remain calm. I made in this definition of neutrality. I'm neither interested nor not interested. I'm neither taking note nor not taking note. I'm neither optimistic nor am I not optimistic. I neither find this helpful nor do I not find it helpful. Remember, the goal is abidance. So anything that takes you out of abidance is not good. It's not good. And so, no matter what happens, we should practice the definition of neutrality. So there seems to be indications that, I mean, I had a dream, what was it, a week ago or a little more a week ago, of Ananda my Ma suddenly emerging somehow, like out of anonymity, and greeting me. And this was a very intense dream of also, and I was, very happy to say, oh wow, this is great. So there's something going on with Ananda my Ma for sure. There's really, there's a lot of signs, but I say I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. And really, this is how I feel. I don't have any. I just feel neutral about it. But ultimately, this is what we want. We want this definitional neutrality where nothing rocks our boat into any sort of definition at all. So I'd say I'm neither interested that she, if she came back, I'm neither interested that she's back or not interested that she's back or whatever it is that's manifesting here. I'm neither interested in what is manifesting nor am I not interested in what is manifesting. But truth be told, I'm not really a fan of her teachings. I really am not. And she would not be bothered by that because she'd always say whatever she says is only a particular angle of perspective based on what the people there wanted to hear. She said she never even said anything on her own. It was only what people wanted to hear. And she put it in a way that they could digest it, like giving food. She's like giving food to everybody, but she gave them the food they were demanding. But I'm the teachings, I'm not really attracted to the teachings. Much prefer Jesus's teachings. Much prefer. And the neither nor the path that I've been on, that's the path I prefer. And I don't relate to all the stuff, information gave out to mostly Hindus, because it's so different. They have so many different paths. And the questions they ask her, I wouldn't ask any of those questions. And so the answers she gave really aren't anything that I'm that particularly interested in. All is the one, see God everywhere, blah, 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 blah. I mean, but. No, I'm interested in practice. So what's the practice? And so the Holy Spirit is what has always given me the practices I want. So for me, my teacher's the Holy Spirit. This is how I look at it. So I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. I'm neutral about it. Jesus' teachings are, I don't know, I just greatly prefer them. I neither greatly prefer them, nor do I not greatly prefer them as a way to stay neutral. But this teaching of neither nor, this practice rather, we do not have to, apply it, robotically to everything. If we want to say something, I prefer this, and this is what we feel, and we feel that this is not something that I need to necessarily put in either nor format. That's fine also. That's fine also. It's an art, not a science here. Because that is true. I very much love the way that Jesus presents truth. I prefer it over his way over all other teachers that I've come across. For not even close, actually. I think it's much more helpful instead of trying to figure everything out, just to practice, get a hold of a practice that you can do, and then do it. I think this is really the way that I see. Ask the Holy Spirit for a practice, whatever it is. I mean, it's not likely you'll be doing the neither nor practice right away. You're probably waiting to see, well, how's it turn out with me? How's it turn out? It's a very important practice because we won't be able to see the world, as the illusion, delusion, self-delusion that it is, until we have the neither nor practice and can maintain definitional neutrality. Because otherwise, what we see is so terrible, we will feel like a tremendous urge to junk it immediately, the whole thing, get rid of it. And that will terrify us because they'll say, "Oh my gosh, wait a minute. Yeah, I hate this world. I hate everything here, but it's a complete cruel hoax, really. We're playing upon ourselves. Terribly cruel hoax. And I want to junk it immediately, but oh my gosh, if I junk it immediately, I don't know what I'll function. I don't know." And it freaks us out. It freaks us out. And so what we do is we go back into delusion and try to embrace the world again. I really got to embrace the world, and you find that suddenly you're feeling attracted to form, to people, to relationships, to the world. You think, oh, it's so attractive. And this is a reaction, a fear reaction. Trying to learn to love the hoax. But if you can practice this neither nor practice of definitional neutrality, then you can say, then you're able to see the world as it is, how terrible it really is. And you say, well, it's neither terrible nor is it not terrible, or whatever your action is. You don't tr you've got an intermediate step of practice. You see, I can practice getting free of this. I can practice getting free of this, as opposed to flinging yourself like out of a catapult or something into reality. Divesting yourself of this hoax. Totally for instantly and forever, which is what we really want to do. Instead of doing that, we say, "Hey, I can practice accepting that I don't want this world anymore. I can practice it." It has to be a powerful practice. But if you have the neither nor practice, you can then just say, "Oh, I can practice this, no problem." See, it gives you this massive advantage. The other way of just trying to divest ourselves of it instantly, forever, evermore, this is never going to work. It's never going to work that way. So we have to practice, practice, practice. So ask the Holy Spirit for a practice every morning. This is what I do. You wake up and you feel, oh gosh, my dreams another day, and say, "Okay, Holy Spirit, I'm really down. I'm really depressed. This is terrible. I don't know how to get through the day. Give me a practice that'll help me get through the day." And then instead of trying to figure everything out, just practice, 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 practice. Now it will happen that your clarity will grow so strong that you will be able to connect the dots, and you will be able to say something like I do in these videos. But that's because of the practice. That's because of the practice, not in spite of it. It's a result of the practice, and the practice is primary, actually. So, as difficult as it may seem, try every day to have some practice that the Holy Spirit suggests. And the Holy Spirit will give you some sort of practice. This has been my experience and testimony. It doesn't have to be the same as me or same as anyone else or anything like that. Just it will be something that is helpful for you. Holy Spirit knows all practices. So we're not really dependent on any teacher or guru necessarily, really. I don't feel that way. I say I'm neither dependent nor am I not dependent. I neither need help nor do I not need help. I'm neither asking for help nor am I not asking for help. Neutral, definitional neutrality on the whole thing, the entire spiritual path, the hoax of the world, bodies, world, everything, just neutral, definitionally neutral on it. And that's all that it takes for us to then begin to feel, the nature of reality, the nature of what we truly are. As long as we take it just a definitional neutral stand, then this enables us to begin to feel the dawn of that, whatever it is, of isness, you might say, dawn of isness, gently, just subtly, begins to creep upon us. And you say, well, I'm neither thrilled nor am I not thrilled about this. I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. I have no definitional position. Just keep practicing. But don't say, why, I don't have any definition. That's too frightening. Say it in a way that seems that we do have a definitional position, even though it's zero. So I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. What is that? It's a zero, isn't it? But it sounds like it for us. It gives us sort of a reassurance that we're taking some definitional position, even though we're not really. The ego will scream, well, that's a trick, it's a trick. No, it's a practice. It's an effective practice. Of course, the ego doesn't like it because it works. But again, whatever, ask for your own practice. The Holy Spirit will give you your own practice. Just ask, 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 ask. All we need is this definitional neutrality. We don't need, I'm neither explaining it nor am I not explaining it. It's neither explicable nor is it not explicable. Neither explicable nor is it not explicable. So if a teacher comes back, you can say, I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. Definitional neutrality. I'm neither interested. This is a great opportunity to practice definitional neutrality, whatever happens. I neither want the car nor do I not want the car. See, I neither want the car nor do I not want the car. That fabulous car. I neither want the car nor do I not want the car. I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. See, we don't need to take any position to experience our true position. That's already the case in reality. So we don't need to establish something new. As Ramana Maharshi said, it's not like you have to do anything new. It's just remove the camouflage that's covering up what's actually there, the camouflage of what's actually there. Just remove that. That's all that's required. I neither want to help out, nor do I not want to help out. I'm neither obliging nor am I not obliging. Who says we have to take a position in order to be everywhere? To be all inclusiveness, abidance. Who says we need to take a position, a definitional position, in order for abidance to be taking place? It's already taking place. And for those who are not getting with it, anything at all in the past, see, I'm neither dismayed nor am I not dismayed. I'm neither dismayed nor am I not dismayed by this. It's neither a pity nor is it not a pity. It's neither a tragedy nor is it not a tragedy. So whatever practice you have, practice, keep practicing as relentlessly as possible. Don't worry about anything else. Don't worry about results. Just keep practicing. Because you'll never be able to define the results anyway. So why even worry about it? Just get used to definitional neutrality, which then when you feel the abidance, you'll say, well, I neither understand it, nor do I not understand it. People say, well, what is it like? Well, it's neither like this, nor is it not like this. It's neither like that, nor is it not like that. It's neither definable, nor is it not definable. It's neither understandable, nor is it not understandable. See, and just leave it at that. That's it. That's both it and not it. That's neither it, nor is it not it. It's neither understandable, nor is it not understandable. It's neither expressible nor is it not expressible. And as we get familiar with this practice, then I believe and I'm counting on this is, you know, the dawning, you know, abidance will dawn upon us. And it's you know, it's neither this nor that. It's neither this nor is it not this. It's neither here nor is it not here. So the ego will always say, well, there must be something that'll get you out of this abidance. And say, well, there's neither something nor is there not something that'll get me out of it. There's neither something that'll get me out of it, nor is there not something that'll get me out of it. Practice, practice, practice. Don't think, 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 think. Practice, 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 practice. The intellect is what's doing thinking, so much thinking. The intellect vastly overestimates its so-called intelligence, and it gets in over its head severely. Like this is the suicide law in California, basically, we're saying today, oh, I guess what? We've all got the right to kill ourselves now, which is true. A legal right to kill ourselves now. And I said, you know, I didn't say this, but I thought, believed this and saw it, that the intellect thinks that it can handle all this stuff, but it's a very slippery slope. And after a while, it just gets in over its head and just says, oh my God, this is, you know, all this unintended consequences and things happening. I thought I had it all figured out and can handle it, but I said, now I'm just in way over my head. This is the problem with the intellect. It doesn't understand the unintended consequences and ramifications. It thinks it can handle everything, so it keeps making these laws that are just going to swamp it, absolutely swamp it. It's a hornet's nest. It's better just to say no. It's not legal. Way, way better. For instance, in Catholicism, it's a mortal sin, absolute mortal sin. A lot of people feel this is just, you know, people hearing this, some people shocked. It was absolutely shocking. It's shocking to me. I thought there's only a few people in the state that wanted it, and it turns out over 70%. That is just absolutely bizarre. But, you know, I'm neither surprised nor am I not surprised. I'm neither interested in this nor am I not interested in it. I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. People say, are you abiding? Well, I'm neither abiding nor am I not abiding. Are you enlightened? I'm neither enlightened nor am I not enlightened. Maybe this camera is me saying, I get the picture. Yeah, you're getting the picture now. Large frame format. They use large 4 inches by 2 inches or something. I don't even know where the film went. I think it was like a single. It went in the back here somehow. I don't know. It's really strange trying to figure this camera out. I can't even figure out how it would work. You know, but it's built so... So astonishingly, you know, everything still works on it after almost 100 years old. It's just like bizarre. The workmanship and the quality of all the metals and everything is just extraordinary compared to our time now. We're, you know, it's just the flimsiness of our times is just absolutely astonishing. There you go. Okay, I gotta pull it out of this little cave and pull this bellows out, this bellows thing. And it's got some, I don't know, it's got something. I don't think I'm an expert at working this. It's, wow. Now it's staying there. Won't move. Oh well. So maybe I'm getting the picture here. Is there a clicker somewhere? No, the shutter is like right here on the little. Somehow this thing is supposed to do something. There you go. Something like that. But yeah, the solidity, I mean, the bellows are still really, really good shape. The metal, everything. It's almost 100 years old. I mean, you do not find anything built like this these days. It's just, it's kind of nice to have something that's really solid. Yeah, I like that. Large format, large negative, very large negative, 2 and 4, 2 by 4. Or is that a sign of something very large negative is coming into the world? Well, it's either, you know, I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. I don't know. You could look at it different ways, couldn't you? Of course, large negatives give a much better picture. So you could be saying that a much clearer picture is emerging. Something historic, it's a historic camera, or something that is hindsight, you know, I don't know, something could be something very profound, actually. We're in a very profound time, outing Agenda 21 and recognizing the incredible troubles that are likely to occur around this. The zealousness, the insane, they call it an infinite energy for activism towards these goals from young people. This is what the UN is aiming at. It's aiming a younger generation to have infinite energy of activism. If you're not concerned about that, I don't know what could be more concerning than that. I mean, because history is full of, you know, revolutions carried out by the young, and of course they're carried out against the old regime. The older people are the targets of this. So the UN says its goal is to activate this infinite energy and passion of activism among the youth, especially highlighting the women. This is a very chilling thing to hear, as if they seem to be ignorant of history. Maybe this camera gives me a historical perspective, something, an oldie but a goodie, a classic, you know, I don't know, some stuff like that. It's old but super durable, still holds up well. A lot of different ways you can look at this. It's very symbolic. Just like the car, the supercar. I was showing the supercar, showing, look at this. I said, oh, well, okay, now I see it. Maybe this means, like, you know, your ride in life is about to get extraordinarily stupendous. So say, what do you call it? Just, your ride in life is about to get extraordinarily beautiful and powerful and smooth and sweet. Very sweet ride. I call it a sweet ride. Your life, your ride in life is about to become very, very sweet. You know, top. This is probably, you know, what it's pointing out. So, I'm neither delighted nor am I not delighted. I'm neither delighted nor am I not delighted. Something very delightful happened. So I'm neither delighted nor am I not delighted. And you keep this stability. You see, it's amazing, isn't it? Practicing like this. Instead of feeling delight, you feel the stability. This like immovable stability, which is what we're really aiming for, is a dawning of this feeling, this subtle feeling that comes dawns of this immutable stability. This is absolute immutable, in all-inclusive stability of presence. And so if we keep practicing this neutrality, you know, I'm neither delighted nor am I not delighted. Well, the reaction of delight is not there. It's not there. It's not there. And we may think, oh my gosh, no, I need all these reactions. That's what makes going to make me happy. No, it doesn't. When has reactions ever made us, given us lasting happiness? Stability. No, whatever comes, goes. Whatever goes, comes, but comes. It's constant, you know, going and coming, coming and coming. So, but what we're really after is something better than that. Ramana Maharshi said that the great peace is better, is the true state, better than than bliss or delight. So we can say, I'm neither, you know, delighted nor am I not delighted. I'm neither blissful nor am I not blissful. He said, Rana makes it very, very clear, the great peace is the great prize, actually. That's the real prize. It's this immutable solidity and stability that there's not even a ripple in it anywhere. So I'm neither excited nor am I not excited. Neither excited nor am I not excited. I'm neither anticipating nor am I not anticipating. And just adamantly stick with this practice. Just abide in this definitional neutrality. I'm neither reacting nor am I not reacting. I'm neither happy nor am I not happy. I'm neither thrilled nor am I not thrilled. I'm neither interested in anything nor am I not interested in anything. I neither have no interest nor do I not have no interest. I'm neither thrilled the teacher is here, nor am I not thrilled the teacher is here. So the goal of the abidance is not to be thrilled that the teacher is here. That's not the goal at all. So he says, I'm neither thrilled the teacher is here, nor am I not thrilled the teacher is here. I'm neither listening to what the teacher says, nor am I not listening to what the teacher says. I'm neither being benefited, nor am I not being benefited. I'm neither getting it nor am I not getting it. Let me even see a viewfinder. I guess there's some crazy viewfinder here that's got this. I don't know. How could that be a viewfinder? This thing is some sort of flash mechanism or something. I don't know. It looks like. I just don't know what that is. Can't be. There's nothing electronic on this thing. But just all the screws are still perfect. Everything is like it's still in such great shape. The springs. And it's just absolutely astonishing that they could make things that would last back then. You see this? And this is what I miss. I miss a world in which stuff lasts. Right now, everything just falls apart. Everything is so flimsy. So flimsy. But I neither care, nor do I not care. See, there you go. I neither care about anything, nor do I not care about anything. I neither care about this, nor do I not care about this. And rather than entering into some void, again, the Holy Spirit told me, it's enough to simply not deny truth, not to take a stance of denying truth, but you certainly don't have to affirm it. Because God's already affirming it constantly for us. It's that which is inherently being affirmed. So there is this inherent reality being affirmed by God. God is affirming reality constantly and eternally. So we just need not to affirm against it. That's all. So by definition of neutrality, we're certainly not affirming against, and yet we're still using the form as if the potential is there. We could be, you know, it's a security blanket, yet we're really not. We're just being neutral. So I neither care about anything, nor do I not care about anything. I neither want anything, nor do I not want anything. I neither want outcomes, nor do I not want outcomes. And by abiding in this definition of neutrality, at the level of concepts and belief and perception, then what is being affirmed by God is what we can experience now. See, God is affirming reality. This is what God is the affirmation that the truth is true. It's God that's affirming that. We don't have to affirm that. It's God. We just need to make sure that we're not affirming against it. So we can say, I'm neither choosing that to accept the truth is true, nor am I choosing to accept the truth is not true. So we're not really affirming anything there. We're just definitional neutrality. And that means then we're just saying, well, whatever is, then is. That's what we're saying. We're just trusting that whatever is, is being affirmed by God, and we don't need to affirm it ultimately to experience it. To experience it, we just need to not deny it. See? I neither have a response nor do I not have a response. Someone might say, what's your response to some teacher coming here in the world? So I neither have a response nor do I not have a response. And you see, you feel the peace and calm that this brings. Oh, what a relief, you know, that we can be this way. We can say this. We can practice this. You know, this is really the blessedness is the practicing here. It's a blessed relief. I neither have a response, nor do I not have a response. Takes you off the hook entirely, doesn't it? Takes you off the definitional hook. I'm neither concerned nor am I not concerned. And I'm neither interested nor am I not interested. I neither care nor do I not care. I neither have a reaction nor do I not have a reaction. So, a lot of great symbols, things are happening that indicate something, you know, extraordinary is emerging. And I neither care nor do I not care. I neither care nor do I not care. I'm neither hopeful nor am I not hopeful. I'm neither exuberant nor am I not exuberant. I'm neither excited nor am I not excited. I'm neither traumatized nor am I not traumatized. I'm neither traumatized nor am I not traumatized. See, whatever it is, definitional neutrality. And it you feel in a different boat. You feel that, hey, this is different. I mean, I don't have to be experiencing all these highs and lows. I can experience something that is absolutely present and stable and profound. I neither want to experience it, nor do I not want to experience it. So is some teacher coming back? Well, I neither care, nor do I not care. I neither care, nor do I not care. And we'd stay grounded, you know, in this. And this is what I believe is going to allow the dawning of abidance to come upon us in this very imperceptibly gentle way that you can't really delineate. And that's it's fine. We don't need to delineate or define. So, For me, I'm gonna try to get some rest and see what gets dredged up again from all this effort, you know. It's oftentimes stressful dreams. Says, wow, what's next? I don't know. So, very great. We'll end this one here. Won't make it go too long. It's already gone 50 minutes. Just an intense neither nor practice. And whatever your practice, keep practicing and at least pay some attention to this neither nor. At least be aware of it, okay? Say if someone's practicing it. So you say, well, I know someone somewhere is practicing this neither nor practice and expecting abidance to be the result of this practice. And it's interesting. Keep it on your radar. Keep this on your radar. And then just ask the Holy Spirit for your practice and just do it. Just practice, practice, practice. This is what's important. Basically, the great teacher will tell you, hey, practice. If you want to be like me, practice. You know, this is where it's at. Okay. And I neither care where it's at, nor do I not care where it's at. That's it.